dirty. Good morning. Welcome to First Presbyterian Church. It is yet another Sunday where we have been blessed to gather to worship the Lord. Let us all rise for the call to worship. That's a reading from Ephesians 2, 8 to 10, and we'll be reading from the ESV. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is a gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast.
For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand, that we should walk in them.
All right, let us pray. Dear Father, the Lord God Almighty, we invite you to gather with us this morning. Please be present with us. Guide us, direct us, teach us, heal us, lead us to worship you in spirit and in truth. Amen. Let us sing hymn number 4, All Praise to God Who Reigns Above.
All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. We live for you. And holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show. Thank you.
Please be seated.
My name is Charles Wagner. On behalf of First Presbyterian Church, I'd like to extend our welcome to everyone with us, either in this room or online. Now, I'd like to have a little show of hands. How many people would like to thank God for some sunshine? We have had enough of rain, I'll tell you, but we are thankful for the rain. If you are visiting with us, we would like to invite you to fill out the information card that you'll find on the back of the chairs in front of you. We invite you to drop that card in the offering plate in a few minutes. Everyone is invited to use that card to share a request with us. And just to guys let you know, there is a class taking place at the library for those who are interested in membership in the church during the Sunday school hour. So we invite you to attend that. Adults, you are invited to attend our Sunday school class entitled The Hope of Heaven or the New Creation. This class, which starts at 10:45, traces creation and the new creation from Genesis through Revelation. Through this study, Michael Collinari gives us a picture of what it will be like when Jesus returns and all things are made new. So just in case any of you wake up at 3 a.m. in the morning and you suddenly have a desire to pick up a bat and a ball and a glove, you want to play softball, please contact Greg Smith because they need a few more softball players on the team. So Greg Smith. And the children's glow and blast programs will not meet this Wednesday night. However, the middle school youth group will meet at 8 p.m. Okay? And so Nathaniel Lee, one of the pastors of our sister church, Center Grace, will now lead us in the baptism of two of our covenant children.
Thank you, Charles. Before I invite the families up, I just want to give a brief description on what baptism is. Maybe it's been a while since we've had a baptism here at FPC, but just to give an update on your thinking of what is baptism. I don't know about you, but I really struggle sometimes with assurance of salvation. I struggle to believe what God's word says about me is true, and I don't think I'm alone there. I think we all struggle to believe what God says about us is true. And what God has given us in baptism is a sign and a seal that his promises are not just true in the abstract sense, but they are true for you. They are applied to you. I'm wearing a wedding ring right now because it's a sign and a seal that I am married. But here's the thing. My wedding ring is not a sign and seal. My sign and seal to Brenna of my love, it's her sign and seal to me. She's wearing my sign and seal. I'm wearing hers. And what we're about to do is we're about to see God's sign and seal of his love to us. I think some people often understand baptism to be primarily our profession of faith, primarily our sign and seal to God's love. But there's one problem with that, is our commitment to God is not nearly as sure as his commitment to us. I don't know if you guys have ever had a dream. I graduated in COVID, so I had this weird recurring nightmare where I never walked across a stage. And so I kept having this dream like that I didn't finish my last seminary papers and exams. And so theoretically, in order to alleviate the fears of those dreams, I would pull up my transcript. I never actually did this, but I could have. Or I would look at my degree and be like, okay, it was just a dream. I actually did graduate. I'm not in the matrix. That actually happened. It's real. It was a sign and a seal, a transcript that I graduated. If you buy a house and someone walks into your home and tries to steal your home and you're trying to prove to the police that it's your house, what do? You pull up the deed to your house. If somebody tries to do it with your car, you pull up the title to your car. There's a certain sense in which these things not only show that the car, the house, the degree is yours, but it proves that the degree is yours. So if you're struggling with assurance of your salvation, if you're struggling with God's love feels incredibly distant, this baptism, these two baptisms we're about to do, they're not just signs and seals to these children. The reformers constantly say, remember your baptism. It's a sign to you as well. It's a sign that even though you don't feel God's love, even though there may be seasons where you feel incredibly distant from God's love, his sign and seal of his promises are much more real than how you feel about his love. And that's such good news. because our hearts are all over the place. And what we need to do is have them anchored by his signs and seals. So I'd love to invite the families up, the parents of Matt and Emily and Owen and Jeb and Awo and Carissa. And if I could get you two to stand on this side, and Matt and Emily, if you want to stand on this side, and then John will come and hold our water, because I can't hold everything. I will ask you all to hold the babies, because I once saw someone scream into a microphone and with the baby, and so I'm terrified for that to happen. But why do we baptize children? As we're seeing here, these are people that are not going to profess the faith yet and be baptized. But they are going to be baptized before they profess their faith. And you may be here, and this is something that you're not understanding, and I totally get it. I wrote my first theology paper on why infant baptism was unbiblical. So why did I change my mind? When I saw my first infant baptism, it was the clearest depiction of the gospel I think I've ever seen. Because as I was sitting there in my heart, I was like, this isn't good. I felt like the Lord say, you know, as I was saying, this infant has no idea what's going on. He was like, neither did you when I called you. You contributed nothing. Nothing, absolutely nothing, except the sin that made it necessary in the first place. So even if you're here and this is something you're not on board with, we just encourage you to see that baptism is primarily God's sign to us. And all throughout Scripture, what we see is families bringing their children to receive the covenant sign. You see this in with Abraham. God says, circumcise Isaac, the Old Testament sign of God's promise, even before Isaac professed faith. And so what we are doing here today is not salvific. It's not causing salvation, but it's a sign. It's a promise that one day Owen and Carissa will claim by hopefully professing faith, maybe even this very church, claiming those promises, as our catechism says, receiving and resting in those promises that have been signed and sealed here on this day. So that's what we are doing here today. We are receiving, or they are receiving names, because all throughout their lives, they're going to be told, you need to achieve your name, you need to accomplish your name, you need to constantly earn your name, and they are going to do something that all of us should do. I received my name. The triune name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And that's the most important thing about me, is his name to us. So Jeb and Awo and Matt and Emily, as Carissa and Owen receive their baptisms, it's meant to be two things for you all, a comfort and also a challenge. It's a comfort to you in the mercy of Jesus that God is merciful and that his grace always precedes our response. We've never done anything good without God enabling us to do it. It's a sign that you are responding to. But it's also a challenge to help them live out the baptism, to live out the name that they are receiving. It is a challenge to each of you that the rest of your lives, one of the most important things that you can do is to model the faith for them, to teach them in word and in deed. All the sociologists will tell you the number one determining factor of whether a child grows up and keeps the faith is how their parents lived out that faith. And so this is a challenge to you. It's also a challenge to you all, because you are promising to assist them in their work of raising the children. It does take a village. That's a biblical idea. They're being baptized not just abstractly, but into this covenant community as members of the church. And so it's a challenge to you all. So parents, hear these covenant promises from God's word from Genesis 17 and Acts 2. For to you is the promise, and to your children, and all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call unto him. And I will establish my covenant between me and you, and your seed after you, throughout their generations for an everlasting covenant, to be a God unto you and your seed after you. Believe on the Lord Jesus, and you shall be saved, you and your house. So what I'll do is I'll ask each of you these same set of questions, and then we'll do Chris's baptism first and then Owen's right after. So Jeb and Awo, do you acknowledge your child's need of the cleansing blood of Jesus Christ and the renewing grace of the Holy Spirit? If so, say yes. Do you claim God's covenant promises on Carissa's behalf? And do you look in faith to the Lord Jesus Christ for her salvation as you do for your own? And do you now Unreservedly dedicate your child to God and promise in humble reliance upon divine grace that you will endeavor to set before Carissa a godly example, that you will pray with and for her, that you will teach her the doctrines of our holy religion, and that you will strive by all the means of God's appointment to bring her up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Amen. Matt and Emily, do you acknowledge your child's need, Owen's need, of the cleansing blood of Jesus Christ and the renewing grace of the Holy Spirit? Do you claim God's covenant promises on Owen's behalf? And do you look in faith to the Lord Jesus Christ for his salvation as you do for your own? And do you now unreservedly dedicate your child to God and promise in humble reliance upon divine grace that you will endeavor to set before him a godly example, that you will pray with and for him, that you will teach him the doctrines of our holy religion, and that you will strive by all the means of God's appointment to bring him up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord? And to the congregation, I will ask you a question. If you're a member, say yes. Do you as a congregation undertake the responsibility of assisting the parents in the Christian nurture of these children? If so, say yes. Amen. Let's pray before we do the baptism. Father, we thank you so much that you have given us signs and seals of your love in the name of your Son by the power of your Holy Spirit. I pray that you would make good on these promises, Lord, that one day Carissa and Owen would profess faith. They would receive rest and live out these promises that you are giving to them today. We pray this in your name, Jesus. Amen. So Carissa, we'll start with you. And John, if I could get you to come forward. Carissa Victoria Adama Boss, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Owen Wilder Hoffman, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Welcome them into the community. Thank you guys. Awesome. Let us all strive as a covenant community to live out these promises that we see have seen today. And welcome them into the community. Welcome, guys. Yeah. One more time. Welcome. Thank you guys.
Let us come before the Lord in prayer. Dear Father, the Lord God Almighty, you are our God and we are your humble people. You are our Creator. You are the one who has given us life. You are the one who has given to us generously throughout each hour of our lives. Our hearts beat because of your love for us. Each breath we take is an expression of your care for us and your mercy towards us. Father, we see today because you gave us amazing eyes and because your Holy Spirit revealed spiritual truths to us. Father, we hear today because of your indescribable superior intelligence to design the ear and connect it to our brains. We also hear today because the Holy Spirit has opened our hearts to hear the word of God. Father, we speak today because you have put words of praise on our tongues, the tongues you designed. You have also given us words of encouragement and inspiration for our brothers and sisters in Christ. Father, we hold, carry, lift, grasp, reach, hug, kiss, walk, run, and even dance because you have blessed us with physical strength and movement. Father, you show your love for us through the people in our lives who treasure and care for us. You give us food to eat, water to drink, a safe place to sleep, and health care. Most of all, dear Father, you have given us forgiveness of our sin. Father, we were sinners. We have rebelled from you. We had decided we can live our lives as we saw fit. We foolishly believed we didn't need you. But even while we were your enemies, you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, to die for our sin. Father, we believe he was born of a virgin. He lived the perfect life that we cannot live. He proved that he was God by the miracles he performed. He told us his mission was to die an excruciating death on the cross. Why would he voluntarily do that, Father? It was the only way that our sin could be forgiven. Father, we believe that the wrath of God that each one of us rightfully deserves was put upon Jesus so that we would not have to experience it ourselves. We believe that Jesus rose again on the third day and ascended into heaven 40 days later. We also believe that Jesus is now the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, sending the Holy Spirit into each of our lives to make us more like him. We also believe, Father, that one day when we die, we will be declared pure and righteous, not because we did anything good ourselves, but because we believe that Jesus washed away our sin forever, as far as the east is from the west. We will dwell with him forever and ever. Dear Father, thank you. Thank you that you hear our prayers and you know our hearts. You know what we need before we ask of you. You know far more what we need than we know ourselves. As our faithful and loving Father in heaven, you are already at work answering our prayers before our lips have even spoken them. You know our weakness. You know our brokenness. You know our failings. Yet, you have an eternal love for us that seeks our good even when we disobey your commands. Thank you, Father. Father, we want to love you with all of our heart, soul, and mind. We want to be motivated to do what is right, not to earn your favor, but simply because we love you and want to please you. Give us the kind of heart that lives to delight you in everything we do and say. Father, as a church, we want to thank you now for your provision of a pastor. You have already chosen him. You have already set the date of his installation here. You have already orchestrated the wonderful things you have called him to do within our church body. You have already ordained the relationships he will have with each one of us. We look forward to that day when our hardworking, our very hardworking and dedicated search committee can't restrain their joy for how you have called just the right man at that perfect right moment. The length of this journey will all make sense when the journey is over. We want to thank you for that, Father. Father, there are brothers and sisters in this church who have great concerns on their minds, perhaps even as they sit amongst us today. We know believers are not to worry or to be anxious. However, that is hard for us to do. Give them strength they may lack. Give them hope of deliverance. Comfort them with the knowledge that Jesus will always be by their side. Father, relieve them of their concerns and let us celebrate your faithfulness to them. Give them health, work, a place to sleep, resolution of conflict, direction and guidance, and freedom from addictions. We empathize with burdens they bear. Help us as a church body to come alongside them and to help them carry their weight. Father, we ask that you speak to us through the words you have put on Sean's heart to share with us from Philippians. Deepen our understanding of Paul's letter to the believers in Philippi. Finally, Father, please bless now our tithes and offerings. We use them to advance the kingdom of God on the North Shore. We ask all of this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Ushers, please come forward to receive our tithes and offerings. And children, you are free to go to children's worship. Today's passage is from Philippians 1, verses 12 to 26. I'll be reading from the ESV. Let us hear the word of the Lord. I want you to know, brothers, that what has happened to me has really served to advance the gospel, so that it has become known throughout the whole imperial guard and to all the rest that my imprisonment is for Christ. And most of the brothers, having become confident in the Lord by my imprisonment, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. Some indeed preach Christ from envy and rivalry, but others from goodwill. The latter do it out of love, knowing that I am put here for the defense of the gospel. The former proclaim Christ out of selfish ambition, not sincerely, but thinking to afflict me in my imprisonment. What then? Only that in every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is proclaimed, and in that I rejoice. Yes, I will rejoice, for I know that through your prayers and the help of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, this will turn out for my deliverance, as it is my eager expectation and hope that I will not be at all ashamed, but that with full courage, now as always, Christ will be honored in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I am to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me. Yet, which I shall choose, I cannot tell. I am hard pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is far better. But to remain in the flesh is more necessary on your account. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with you all for your progress and joy in the faith, so that in me you may have ample cause to glory in Christ Jesus because of my coming to see you again. This is the word of the Lord.
It's a delight to be back with you all, and indeed an honor to be what on old TV shows they used to call a special guest appearance in this series on Philippians, which is being done, of course, by my dear friend, colleague, and boss, Mateus de Campos. So I feel a little bit of extra pressure as well, trying to keep up the standard he set last week and undoubtedly will continue through the coming weeks. But it is a pleasure to be with you, and a joy to preach from this wonderful little book of Paul. So as we turn to God's word, let's turn to him first in prayer. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are grateful for this beautiful day. Thank you that whatever the circumstances of our lives may be, you are indeed with us. And so we pray as we think of Paul's words of encouragement from his own prison cell that you would encourage us no matter where we are, to take hope, to rejoice, and to walk in your ways. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, a couple of months ago, I was at I was doing a debate at a local college on whether religion is good for society. And after I and my opponent had done our bits, students were able to get up and give their own little semi-impromptu speeches, and I vividly remember one of them because this fella had learned one of the rules of public speaking, that you ought to repeat your main point constantly. And so he kept saying, "We can all agree that we're making progress as a society." And he said it like five times. And the only problem was, I was sitting there, and I don't think I was alone, thinking, "Really? Are we? Are you really sure about that?" Oh, yeah. Cell phones, which didn't even exist within most of our lifetimes, just get better and better. And so we make technological progress. We've certainly made some social progress in terms of more equality and more welcome for people of different backgrounds. That's great. But when we think of all sorts of other things, morality, emotional health, right? Just a sense of what does it mean to be a human being in the world, it's actually incredibly difficult to say that we as a society are really making progress. And for our Canadian friends, that would be progress. So anytime I say progress in this sermon, you just immediately insert that and you'll know what's going on. Now, the reason I thought of this debate and that little speech in terms of today's passage is because progress really is the key theme of this passage. It bookends these verses 12 to 26. If you listen carefully, look at the beginning, verse 12. I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that what's happened to me has really served to advance the gospel. It's working towards the progress of the gospel, would be a literal translation. And then at the very end, convinced of this, Paul says, I know I'll remain and continue with you all for your progress and joy in the faith. And so progress is at the beginning, progress at the end. You could even say it's one of the major themes of the epistle is how do we make progress as Christians? What's that all about? So we're not so much interested in progress as a human thought in terms of our society, whatever country we're from. We're really thinking of what's real progress in the Christian life. How do we think about that? As so often preachers do, I've got 3 points. I'm going to do the first two fairly quickly and then settle in a little more on the third and final one. So first of all, we learn in the first half of this passage that progress consists in part in keeping the big picture in mind, keeping the big picture in mind. As you learned last week, Paul's been imprisoned for his faith. He's in dire straits, but he doesn't simply dwell on his misfortune. He's content because despite his imprisonment, the gospel is going forth. And so in the big picture, the real question is the progress of the kingdom of God. So society will go as it will, making some gains and considerable losses on the way. The real core of our faith is the progress of the gospel. Paul says in verse 13, it's become known throughout the whole imperial guard and to all the rest that my imprisonment is for Christ. Now, this word for imperial guard can have two meanings. Not to get too deep into the weeds of the historical background here, but praetorian can mean the kind of personal bodyguard of Caesar, which would suggest an imprisonment in Rome, but it can also mean a royal official's palace, which could be all over the empire. Now, thankfully, I did watch Dr. DeCampus's fine sermon last week, and he, like me, believed that it was, in fact, a Roman imprisonment, and so Paul is surrounded by this imperial guard, and yet his reaction is not fear, his reaction is not despair. He continues to be an evangelist, and so he's happy in some sense that he's able to share the gospel with these influential Roman soldiers. Even in jail, he remains an evangelist, and more than that, he has his eye on what's happening outside, namely that his imprisonment has caused others to preach the gospel more boldly. And so again, he takes that big picture perspective, focused not on his limitations, on his struggles, but on the overall progress of the gospel. Some of them are his friends, and they look at him and think, wow, he was imprisoned for his faith, but he's maintaining a strong spirit. He's really giving a beautiful testimony. So I'm going to take up the baton in his place, and I'm going to preach all the more forcefully. And there are these other guys, we don't know really much about them, but they don't like Paul. They're kind of mean and think, well, he's not around, I'm going to preach my version of the gospel. Now, it's got to be the case that there's enough truth in what they're saying that Paul can be excited about it, right? Because some of Paul's opponents were preaching a false gospel, and he wouldn't be happy about that. But it would appear that in the ancient church, as in the modern church, not everybody was like the nicest person in the world. We sometimes have this imagined nostalgia that, well, oh, I wish we could be like the early church. And I'm always thinking, like, which one do you mean? Corinth was a guy living with his mother-in-law and they're visiting prostitutes, just crazy stuff. Or, what church are you talking about? So there were people personally didn't like Paul, in fact, who wanted to annoy them by their own evangelistic endeavors, and yet Paul's like, I don't care. If they're proclaiming Jesus, then I'm content with that. So progress, first of all, consists in seeing the big picture and thinking about the progress of the kingdom. And as I reflected on an application for this, I was thinking myself of the big picture of the progress of the kingdom. And we know that in America, statistics would indicate that in some respects, the church attendance and attendance at Christian colleges and all these other things that touch us deeply are on the decline. We further know that just in our little corner of the world here on the North Shore, that we're struggling, you're struggling to find a pastor over my church in Hamilton. We're struggling to find a pastor. It can be very, very discouraging. And yet, if we lift up our eyes, like Paul, if we acknowledge, as we'll see in a moment, acknowledge the difficulty of our situation, but recognize that the gospel's exploding in all sorts of other parts of the world. Maybe not the North Shore, maybe not the U.S. as a whole, but elsewhere around the world, the gospel's going forth, and in that, we should rejoice. And that will be one way that we help make progress in our faith, keeping that big picture in mind. Secondly, and in some ways balancing that first perspective, is that progress also consists in a realistic assessment and acknowledgement of your situation, including its difficulties. We so often think, particularly in American culture, that progress consists in a perpetually sunny, optimistic attitude. I think of the film Ed Wood with Johnny Depp starring as the director of many of Hollywood's worst films of all time. And when somebody from the studio says that last picture was the worst film ever made, his response on the phone is, "Well, the next one will be better," which it hardly could fail to be so. But we tend to think progress consists in a perpetually sunny, optimistic attitude. Indeed, not even recognizing difficulties, not acknowledging them, because that would slow us down. We're just always going to be happy and put on a smiling face for the world. Not so Paul. Now, this requires a closer look at verses 18 to 26, because Paul does keep a positive attitude, as we've seen. And so as you scan the text there in verses 18 and following, you see Paul says in verse 18, "I will rejoice that through your prayers and the help of the Spirit of Jesus, this will turn out for my deliverance, that he won't be ashamed, that with courage he'll keep honoring Christ by life or by death." Gives that stirring verse many of us treasure, "For to me to live is Christ, to die is gain." And he says, "If I keep living, I'll have fruitful labor, but if I die, I'll be with Christ," and that's even better. "But because you Philippians need me, it'd be great for me to stay around, and so I'm confident I'll stay around and come and see you again." So it sounds as if he's giving us that kind of relentless optimism that I just said is not necessary for Christian progress. But if you think about it, if you attend to it a little more carefully, you'll see that Paul is recognizing that things are very far from perfect in his life. And believe it or not, this shows up most clearly in that very famous verse I highlighted, "For to me is to live is Christ, to die is gain." And that verse 21 can seem almost like a kind of heroic slogan meant to inspire us. It could even seem, if you took it, I think, the wrong way, as a kind of macho statement. "I'm so hardcore, me as live as Christ, die as gain, I don't care." And then you feel that and you think, "Oh boy, I'm not like that at all. I feel kind of like a bit of a screw up sometimes, and I doubt, and I waver, and I get sad about things, and I just fall so short of Paul's example." But that statement, "For me to live is Christ, to die is gain," is in fact a sober assessment, a realistic acknowledgement of Paul's dire situation. And it's related to his, in some ways, to his unique life circumstances. So think about it first, to live is Christ. Now, in some sense, that's true for all of us, right? That we all want to have Jesus at the center of our lives. We want to live like him. We want to live for him. But Paul, that is the literal truth of his whole existence, right? Jesus knocked him off his horse on the road to Damascus, commissioned him and said, Paul, your one job for the rest of your life is to proclaim me, whom you've been persecuting up to this point. That's his one thing he's meant to do. And so when he says to live is Christ for him, that is concrete, easily said to be the defining mantra of his existence. To live is to proclaim the gospel, no matter the cost. And furthermore, when we think to die is gain, that too speaks to the difficulties he encountered as an apostle. As great as his commission was, as great as his glory was to proclaim the gospel to the Gentiles, to write half the New Testament, to be remembered and proclaimed even here, as great as his achievements, as great as his commission was, so great were his sufferings, such that dying really would be a gain for him. Because he doesn't always speak in these drastic terms, right? It's sitting by the river in Philippi when he's free and they're having a nice picnic lunch, he could enjoy the good things of God's creation. He tells us elsewhere that he knew how to abound. He knew how to rejoice in God's good works. He wasn't perpetually thinking, oh, I wish I could get out of this dump, get up to heaven. No, he had a robust theology of creation. He valued his friends. He valued the beauty of the world. But here in prison, just one more thing is his friend Epaphroditus almost died, and that bummed him out, and he's just not free. And so as he thinks through all this, he acknowledges, yeah, life is really hard for me. And objectively, not just as a slogan or an inspiration, but objectively, he'd be better off in heaven with Jesus. And so Paul here and throughout his letters regularly acknowledges the difficulties he has in his life, and he recognizes that that's part of the path of progress that he's on. And so he is helping us to understand that lament and acknowledgement of difficulty is still very useful, very critical in the Christian life, that moving forward is not simply a matter of saying everything's fine, not simply of saying the next one will be better. It's a matter of recognizing the brokenness of the world and the fact that we're all caught up in that maelstrom of the brokenness of the world. That brings us to our third point then. We've seen that progress means keeping the big picture in mind and the progress of God's kingdom. We've seen that it also acknowledges the difficulties of life. And now we come to our third point, but the astute among you, and I think that's pretty much a 100% ratio here, or not ratio, percentage, may have noticed a problem. Problem is, I got 3 points, but I have no runway left because I've already preached up through verse 26. And nothing, nowhere to go, it would seem. Well, the good news is there is a valid point 3, but it's hidden underneath the verses we just talked about in point 2, verses 18 to 26. There is a subtle but immensely powerful lesson tucked under Paul's whole discussion we just talked about of life's hard, but I'll stay around, etc. But to discern that, to see that Paul is making a critical point here, and that point, by the way, is real progress consists in growing in Christ-like love. And I learned from that fellow at the debate that I should say that again because it's really important. Real progress consists in growing in Christ-like love. To see that point, we actually need to jump ahead in Philippians to the most important passage in the book and to see how that's going to cast light on Paul, what Paul has just done in verses 18 to 26. I'm referring to the so-called hymn to Christ in Philippians 2, verses 5 to 11, but the introduction to that hymn in verse 4 is also important. It's one of the greatest passages in all of Scripture. It condenses the gospel to just a beautiful poetic meditation on Christ's sacrifice on our behalf, but it's also going to inform why Paul did what he did in the first chapter, talking about his life, and he'd like to be in heaven and all the rest of it. So I am going to take time to read it. Naturally, Dr. DeCampos will be sharing about this with you in future weeks, no doubt. But it's so rich, it's so awesome that I don't even hesitate to give you more of it because it's so worth thinking about. So Philippians 2, verses 4 to 11, Paul says, "Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped or exploited or held on to, but instead emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. And being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father." I am tempted to give a sermon within a sermon on this magnificent passage, and I will restrain myself simply to point out the beautiful shape of Christ's life, that though he is in heaven, glorified with God, he chooses to come to earth, not only to do that, which would be humbling enough, but to die, and not only that, but to die on a cross, a humiliating death, and then arguably the most important little word in the whole Bible, verse 9, "Therefore, God highly exalted him." And we're so tempted to translate that word or to think of it as although Jesus humbled himself, God exalted him. No, because Jesus humbled himself, therefore God exalted him. In a nutshell, because Jesus was the only one who never wanted to be in charge of everything and was willing to let that go, God sees that he is the one who is indeed worthy to rule over all things. As I've said, Dr. DeCampos will preach more on that later. I do want to point out one thing, that when Jesus takes on human flesh and humbles himself, he's not doing something that God wouldn't do. He's not becoming less than God or becoming other than God. He is showing us what God's love looks like when it takes on human existence in a broken world. He is truly being God in human flesh, and because of our need, as so beautifully articulated in the prayer earlier, because of that, it takes up the image of vulnerable service. In any event, Christ is our example of love. That's the key point. Remember, it begins, "Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus." Christ is the supreme example of service and love. And that notion that he's an example is really the critical thing I want to dwell upon here for the remaining time we have. Because the language of the hymn doesn't just stay here in chapter 2, verses 4 to 11. If you look down in chapter 2 just a little bit, we'll see that the language of this passage is picked up in the description, first of all, of Timothy, Paul's friend and helper. Verses 20 and 21 read, "For I have no one like Timothy who will be genuinely concerned for your welfare." Listen to this, "For they all seek their own interests, not those of Jesus Christ." Right? So Jesus Christ looked out for the interests of other people, and Timothy does the same thing. He's just like Jesus. Epaphroditus, another friend of Paul, is yet another example of Christ-like service held before us in Philippians as a model. This comes out in verses 29 and 30. So receive Epaphroditus in the Lord with all joy and honor such men, for he nearly died for the work of Christ. Now you think, well, that sounds sort of like Jesus, but not exactly. And I'm going to do something I seldom do, because usually if a pastor says, in the Greek, what follows will be misleading or wrong, but in this case it's helpful, that in the Greek, when it says in verse 8 that Jesus was obedient to the point of death, it says mekri thanatou, and guess what exact same phrase is used when it says Epaphroditus nearly died, came to the point of death, mekri thanatou, not a coincidence. Exact same phrase, because that word can either mean up to and including death, as in the case of Jesus, or up to but not including death, in the case of Epaphroditus. Epaphroditus is still alive. But the point is, Epaphroditus is so committed to the Philippians that his experience of near death is a mirror, a reflection of Jesus' own death for our sins. Yes, Jesus' death is unique. Yes, only Jesus' blood can save. Nonetheless, it is also an example of loving service which can be realized, enacted by human beings like Timothy and like Epaphroditus and like Paul. Well, where's that come out? It already did. It already did. And so we need to go back to verses 18 and following and think of it from a little bit of a different angle now. We've seen that Paul's soliloquy, his expression of his anguish, his struggles, his confidence, right? He gives this lengthy exploration of his soul, and it seemed as if he might just be venting or sharing, as we say. But let's look a little closer at the precise model Paul holds forth here. What's he say about himself? He says, in effect, I'd rather be in heaven with Jesus, because that would be better for me. But you guys need me to be here on earth so I can continue to instruct you, encourage you, and help you. And while in one sense, where I am is out of my hands, I'm going to choose and pray and be confident that I will not be in heaven, which would be great for me. Instead, I'm going to be on earth, which will be good for you. That is exactly the point of the hymn. And so Paul wasn't just giving us a little psychological profile. He wasn't just sharing his feelings. He was subtly but powerfully giving the Philippians a model of what it means to not look to your own interest, to your own convenience, to your own benefit, but to think about the interests of others. And Paul's example is at least as powerful as Timothy and Epaphroditus, because he could want to be in heaven and happy, but instead he'll endure suffering on earth for their sake. Paul is showing the Philippians, offering them a model, not in a boastful way, in a subtle way, but a very powerful way of what Christ-like love and service looks like. Well, turning as we close to the application, we could go in a couple of different directions here. We could obviously think about the myriad ways in which we too might offer Christ-like service to others, even when it's inconvenient for us. So we could think, you know, about going to school, and rather than just focusing in on your own achievement, your own grades, and your college you're going to get into, maybe it looks like helping other students learn, setting up a study group and trying to help them, not just get things for yourself. If maybe you're going to work in a shop, so-called service jobs, how can that really be Christ-like service as you deal with customers, right? As you wait on the tables, you're at the cash register. How do you do that in a way that would honor Jesus? We could think about that, but what I want to do instead is just meditate for a moment on this whole idea of examples and how important they are for the Christian life. As I've said, Jesus at the centerpiece of the epistle, it's not just a kind of abstract theology. Paul tells the story of Jesus as a model for our own attitude that we ought to have. And then he holds out Timothy as an example. He holds out Epaphroditus as an example. And as we've seen, he holds himself out subtly but powerfully as an example of Christ-like service. And isn't it true that most of what we learn by looking, not by having somebody say something to us, right? We learn by looking at others. And this is true in everyday life, not just spiritual matters. I was thinking of what's probably our most successful institution of higher learning in the States, YouTube University. I learned that phrase just a few months ago, but it's a helpful one if you don't know what it refers to. It's all those videos online that help you learn how to do stuff, right? Now, we value professional tradesmen and the work that they do, but when you're looking to fix a stuck toilet handle or install a stair runner, things that you're able to do but you don't know how, it's just incredibly helpful to Google and watch somebody else do it. Now, there are good examples and bad examples, right? There's the guy who's got this 20-minute video on fixing the toilet, and half of it is like, well, I went to Home Depot, and I was looking in aisle 20, but then he's 20 minutes opening the package, like, dude, edit. But the useful ones are just incredible. They're just so helpful because you see people do it. If you got a list of instructions, right, it's like putting IKEA furniture together. What? You see someone do it, you learn. And how much more, of course, in our spiritual lives. That's how we learn, is by looking at good examples. How do you learn to deal with a difficult situation in the office where you need to be firm, but you also want to be respectful? You can't just read a book and have, you witness that. How do you speak up in a meeting to a boss who's talking, looking to bring the company in a bad direction, and you want to say what you need to say, but you want to do it in a way that doesn't just look like you're power grubbing and, showing off or anything. How do you do that? You learn that by seeing other people do it gracefully, right? We imitate. We learn by looking. And so examples are at the core of the Christian life. We learn by looking. But of course, this is where it gets tricky, because we all like to see good examples, right? Seeing the example is one thing. Being the example is quite another. And that's a challenge, is it not? I don't know about you. I'm getting old, but I still think of myself as somebody who just should be looking up to other people and learning from them. But it's frightening to realize people are looking at you as an example. Now, if you're a leader, you're teaching, you're an elder or something, that's pretty obvious, and hopefully you feel, in a good sense, the weight of needing to be a good example. But each one of you, just by virtue of being a Christian in this particular society, people are looking at you as an example. What does it mean to be a Christian? You are their lesson. For good or ill. And so we need to ask ourselves, what are they looking at when they look at you? When you go to school, when you go to the workplace, your kids at home, parents, I don't have to tell you about that. You know, we didn't need cell phones to record all our speech, because kids will do that for you. And so they'll be mouthing back things you've said, and sometimes it's not too pretty. So we do need to see the examples, but we also need to be the examples. And we're back then to specifically how do we enact that, and that's a challenging question. We won't have time to explore that, but just remember, you learn by looking, you learn by example, but you also need to be that example of Christ-like service. But I do have one final point. Talked a minute ago about YouTube University, and that's really, really helpful. But you know what's even more helpful? When you got a friend who's willing to come over and show you how to do things and help you when you just can't get through a major problem. And in God's providence, this literally happened to me yesterday. Had the fence, which, you know, it's getting a little wild with the winds around here. Is it just me, or has it been blowing fences down everywhere? And our gate came off, twisted off its hinges. And so I was looking to fix it, and I'm not handy at all. But my neighbor came out, who's incredibly handy, said, "Hey, give me a little advice." Comes over, tells me what I need to get, and we work together. And by 1 p.m., the fence was fixed. I took a picture, sent it to my wife, who's away, and is just so proud, so excited. Because that's what you really need, is a friend who'll help you through it. And just let me remind you that Jesus, who does give us an example to follow, that's clear from the letter, but he's also a friend who's with us to help us be that example we need to be. And so we conclude with another well-known and very important verse from Philippians, this time from chapter 2, verses 12 to 13. Paul says, "Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling." In our case, that means, yeah, you need to be that good example. You need to think concretely, how do I show the love of Christ in the workplace, at school, in the family? "Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, for it's God who works in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure." Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for what we see when we look at the life of Jesus and life of Paul and others. Thank you, even in this church, for those who have helped us by their example to learn what it is to love like Jesus. And so we pray that you would empower us through your Spirit, encourage us day by day to keep those models before us, and with you working within us to show your love to the world. If we ask it in Jesus' name, amen. Jesus has great love for us, and so we want to sing about this now in the great hymn of Charles Wesley, "Love Divine, All Loves Excelling." Let's sing together. Stand as we do.
Thank you.
As always, you have the opportunity for prayer after the service. If you're feeling you're not moving forward, making progress, you're stuck in your Christian life, then they'd be happy to pray with you. We'll have our closing prayer followed by the doxology. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that your love came among us, dwelt among us, empowers us, and equips us to show that same love to others. May we live this way day by day in the hope of joining you in heaven and the resurrection and the life everlasting. Be with us with that joyful message each day, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.